Good afternoon, Velocipedians, and welcome to a reveal video. They're always exciting ones. It's been a busy old time at the Velocipedium. Things going on, trying to catch up with all those jobs I told you about. And we've had a new arrival, we've had a departure, a bit of horse trading, and most importantly, a new arrival. So, without further ado, this is it. It is a 1933 New Hudson, and it's the City model, the City Gents model, and chromium plated model. So, bit of a mouthful, but chromium plated because of the chrome accessories and things. A bit of a super deluxe kind of spec. And it is a 23 inch frame, 26x1 3/8 tyres, so the same sizes really as all my rallies. It's your 26 inch wheeled 3-speed roadster. It has a Sturmey Archer K series hub, stamped K3, which is how we get the 1933. Then I looked up some 1933 catalogues and there it is. Exactly the same. You can see it's got the quadrant shifter, such like. I'm going to do a detailed look in a minute, once you've had a look at what it is. Now, it came to me from a subscriber, whom, for the sake of argument, we shall call John, because that's his name. And John watched the last video, the look through the fleet and everything. He spotted a project bike that he fancied. He emailed me saying, are you doing anything with that, or would it be available? Yeah, available, definitely. So we did a deal. I delivered it round to his house, and you know how it is when enthusiasts get together. It becomes a bit of a show and tell. So it was a case of shining a torch into the back of one of the sheds, and they're hanging up. See what I've got here, look, it's a New Hudson. And that was it, I was smitten. I wanted the bike there and then. The proportions, the lines, the age, what it is, the fact it's a premium model, it's got the K-series, it's got the quadrant shifter, it was everything I want, really. So, of course, it's not something that I planned for. It's not a rally. But that's what it's like in collecting, isn't it? These things come. And you think you're not going to get something, you think you're looking for a certain model, and then something like that, you know, you pop around to some guy's house. He's only a mile and a half away, about 2 kilometres. You pop around to somebody's house and they show you a bike. Without me actually saying, the second time I popped around, he basically said, well, it's yours if you want it. And we came to a deal involving a bit of horse trading. There was the project bike, and there's some wheels involved. There's even a trailer load of logs involved from a tree that I took down lately, and he's got a wood burner. So these things all come into a nice little deal. I sold my stash of molten spares, which funded the rest, and here we are. I mean, I wondered at first why he would want to sell on such a bike. The fact is, it's too small for him. He's an inch or two taller than me, and you know, if a bike's too small, it's too small. You can't polish that out. So he had to move it on. So let's have a closer look at exactly what the bike is, what we've got, the condition, and what I'm going to do. Now, first thing, let's get it clear, I'm not restoring it. A few years ago, yeah, maybe it might have been a bare metal repaint and back to showroom condition and all that. That's just not where I am these days. I think it's where a lot of us are these days. I think that's kind of worn off. Vintage and patina have become more of a thing. Yes, I used the dreaded P word, but you know, patina, distinctive wear and tear, wearing its age with dignity is what I call it. And this bike absolutely does that. Now, as you can see, somebody's been at it with some black paint at some point. That's not John. John rescued it from a shed in another part of town, and he said it was covered from end to end in just thick, horrible grime, which he spent ages cleaning off. I can believe that when you look down inside some of the back, the backs of things. Yeah, it was probably pretty horrible. And he's pretty good at cleaning bikes up, having seen his other bikes. So he's done quite a nice job of bringing this into presentable condition. Presentable and very original. So here we are. Let's start from the front and work back, shall we? And why not start at the front? This is shown in the catalogue as mudguards with front extension. And true enough, this is this pedestrian killing spear point here. And it's steel, you know, that's going to hurt. That is a separate part to the mudguard. I felt it, and there's a join here where the one overlaps the other. So yeah, I love that feature though. How cool is that? A hint of the steampunk about it as well. Absolutely outrageous, really. Now the next thing to look at, let me turn the wheel so we can see it in the sunlight better. These are the patented New Hudson centre pull brakes. They're like what's known as a bell crank. Get that out of the way. You pull up on this cable, and it pulls a bell crank, bell shaped crank, which pushes out on the arms. So it pushes the pair of arms out, which pivot on here and go onto the rims, with the return spring there as well. Now, as you can see, the cable is wrapped up there. It's in its original housing, which unfortunately is knackered. It's a double-ended cable, so there is a pear nipple inside of the saddle there, which I'll show you when I take them apart. And then there should be a pear nipple on this end that goes into the lever, and it's snapped inside. So that's one of the things that needs doing. I need to make up a new cable with pear nipples on either end. So that'll be a good thing to show you anyway. Rear cable is fine. It has had a replacement out at some point in its life, I think. So that would indicate maybe just a whole replacement cable at some point. And here is where it is in the lever with a pear nipple again. So I'll make the front one the same as that one, but the appropriate length. Nice pair of tourist handlebars, one piece with the stem. Lucas, King of the Road bell. These grips, unfortunately, are plastic, so obviously they're later replacements, maybe in the 60s and 70s. The original ones would have disintegrated. Now, I looked at this, and of course, on the surface, it seems like an obvious recipient for those beautiful ebonized oak black grips. Unfortunately, looking at the bars, I think that's a constant curve. I don't think there's a straight section as such, and certainly not long enough for those extra long grips. So unfortunately, I think that's a no-no. I have a box full of black grips of different periods. I'm sure I'll have something in there. So moving down, we have the Sturmey Archer quadrant shifter. Again, somebody's been at it with the black paint. The actual lever is chrome, so I think the whole thing would have been chrome or nickel. So that's going to be burnished nicely. And here as well, we have the cable rems of. This cable slots into the receiving sleeve there. There's a slot underneath it, and that has the same end as a normal Sturmey Archer cable, where it goes into the trigger shifter. It's got exactly that same long, slim end on it. And this cable would go over the wheel and into the back end here, where it's got, again, the one piece, sort of up to 1960s really, they had the one piece cable with the barrel adjuster permanently on, which I will show you now. And this too has the same end on the cable, which it won't focus on, of course. Let me bring this up to where you can see. There we are. That's what it's got on each end of this cable. So again, I'm going to have to do the same job, melt the nipple off an old cable and attach it to a new cable of the right length. I could, of course, just run a brand new Sturmey Archer cable with the usual clamp on barrel adjuster, but let's do it nice and original, let's make it look right. While we're down here, I might go shortcut and go straight to the rear hub. Let's turn it around. You see it's got an oiler on. I'll just spin it around for you to see the lettering. And there we are, there's the money shot. Sturmey Archer, 3-speed. And below we have the stamp K3, which indicates 1933. This does have a through and through indicator rod, like the F series of 4-speeds. So I'm glad it's got the indicator rod in it. I did do another bike, a Humber, for someone with a K-series hub in like this, and it didn't have one. Oh dear. Nightmare that bike was. Similar type of chain case to you'd find on a rally, just slightly similar around the back end. And now should we wait for the train, I wonder? Oh yeah, that was the Blackpool Preston train. And here on the back end we've got a better view of the bell crank centre pull brake, and you can see this one comes with its own mounting plate which mounts between the seat stays. Thusly. This light is useless for filming. Maybe I'll go to some shade to show you the details. This gives you an idea of the general condition though. Nice and original, although someone has been at it with a paintbrush and black paint. That's easily taken care of. This new Hudson on here is obviously not original. Someone has got some letter transfers and applied it. Unfortunately, they've applied in a manner that's neither horizontal to the ground nor parallel with the chain case, so I shall take care of that. I have on order the correct fancy script, a gold copper plate script, new Hudson for there, and another one which goes on top of the down tube facing the left side of the bike so it can be read from the other side. And then on the seat tube there is another transfer goes on there, which is also on order, but it does get hidden by the pump because the pump pegs are original. And on the subject of transfers, look at this. Another thing is to do with the painting process, I think it's sealed or something, but you can see just above the pump peg, new, as though Hudson is next to it. So the pump peg has actually been applied above the transfer, over the transfer, and so has the gear cable wheel as well. So when I take those both off, because you can see they've had the black paint applied at some point, they're going to get a burnishing as well. When I take them off, I'll have a better look at that transfer and see if we can put it back on, revealing the transfer a little bit better. And you can see in this strong sunlight as well, you can see that at some point that chain case has had paint applied. So that's just going to be a nice buff job really. You can see there is some reflection, some hint of reflection of the crank in there, so yeah, we're all right, we're going to be all right for bringing the paint back. Certainly on the main tube the paint's original. Obviously we need proper clips on there instead of the zip ties, that goes without saying. It has the number 7 shaped seat post that was common in those days. That I think is partly what's making John feel as though the bike's too small for him, to be honest, because it makes the bike effectively shorter. Sorry about that camera work there. It makes the bike effectively shorter by bringing the saddle forward. I think I will have to replace that with a straight seat post and put the saddle on conventionally, because that's going to make it too short for me as well, unfortunately. And it'd be nice if I can get the handlebars further up. I don't know if that'll happen or not, if that's possible. Two points I still want to look there to show you. Brazed on lamp bracket, that's original and part of the premium specification of the bike. And you see the fork crown cover here, embossed with the new Hudson. The trademark is called the Smith's Arm, and it's a blacksmith's arm with his hammer. Beautiful head badge, that's going to polish up nicely. But the gold, you notice the gold. Now, I just thought, oh, gold paint. And I read in a couple of places about a gilded head tube. So I looked a bit closer and I have scraped it with a thumbnail. I think that might well be gilding, not just paint. So there's a new skill. I've never gilded anything in my life, but there's a new skill I could learn. Can you imagine this with a gilded head tube? How pretentious is that? But how wonderful it would look. Marvellous. Beautiful sweep to the forks, lots of rake. So although this is your 26x1 3/8 roadster, it is probably a longer wheelbase than my sports light roadsters. It is classed as a sports frame because the catalogue does advertise it as fully brazed up rear triangle, and that was the denoter of a sports type frame, really, the pencil stays, as they called them, slim seat stays. And the fact that it's brazed here, it hasn't got an extra bolt in there. Now moving to the other side, very nicely made bottom bracket. There's some craftsmanship going on there, and the pump peg again there. A nice brass capped oiler for the bottom bracket. The front hub also has a nice oiler in it, and of course the rear K-series hub comes equipped with one. There isn't one though in the top of the chain case like there would be of a rally of this period. Again, we've got more of this kind of semi-matte brushed on paint. That's going to be just a bit of paint rectification, and you can see better here how the rear brake fastens on. Mudguard, you can see, can you see the remnants there of a coach line originally? And then coming to the back of the bike, a distinctive new Hudson rear reflector. The mudguards are probably the most original part of the bike. You can see remains of a transfer there. Now I did think of ordering a transfer for that, but really there's so little paint. If I start putting the transfer over the bare metal, it'll just look weird. So that's my plan, really, is to bring it up as best I can without repainting it. There might possibly be a couple of little bits of paint I can do, but I'm not going to start respraying things. It might just be touching in, such as there maybe, but nothing significant, nothing that's going to look too much like a touch-up. It would be a light touching in and then a sand back. The paint on the back of there where it's been applied, you can see it's probably been applied over bare metal and it's looking a bit thin. Attempting to spray a coat of black on the inside of that, I don't know. I'll try not to. I want to do the minimum. You know, I want to bring it back to good rideable condition. So linseed oil will be involved, I'm sure. We've had the anchor wax debate in the comments already. Yeah, anchor wax is fantastic stuff, but on this particular bike, it's not going to go out in the winter, so it's not going to go out in the wet very much. I think it's going to be linseed oil. I will give just the lightest of tickles with some 1500 wet and dry, used wet, just to take off the surface rust on there, and then get the old linseed oil on it. And parts like the metal parts that have been painted black. Oh, there's another one. Who doesn't like stopping for a train, eh? Yeah, metal parts that have been painted black will be burnished as best I can. The phrase "as best I can" seems to pop up a lot. Brooksby 66 saddle or this one? I mean, this saddle is, it's not vinyl, it's Rexine, which is an early form of leather substitute, used a lot on the interiors of the likes of Austin Sevens and such like. So it is more of an economy touch than a premium touch. It's a nice original Rexine saddle. Certainly it can be used on something, if not on this actual bike. I'll see how I get on with this or Brooks. Now, one final thing of note regarding finish is the wheels. This was the Chromium special, and sure enough, the wheel rims were chrome, but not just that. Look at this. Lovely, lovely dual pinstripes. Not only dual pinstripes, but originally between those pinstripes there was black paint. It was quite a traditional motorcycle thing, that the centre stripe would be painted black with gold edging, and then the outer parts of the rim would be plated. And I think that was to stop it looking too grubby when it accumulated muck in there. It's got brass spoke nipples. So, one bit of paint I am thinking of doing is restoring the black stripe down the middle of the rims. You can see the chrome's worn off on the braking surfaces quite markedly. So that'll be burnished. And the edge chrome here brought up as best I can. And paint the middle bit black and polish the spoke nipples. I think that'll just give it a little bit of, it's not bling, it's certainly not bling because it's original to the bike. It'll just highlight the premium quality of the bike. And that's the thing with this bike. This wasn't a factory floor worker's going to work bike. It probably was a going to work bike, as most were back then in Britain in 1933. And most bicycles, unless it was a weekend time trial enthusiast that wouldn't have a bike like this, most bikes of this sort were for going to work. But this certainly wasn't for the factory floor worker. This is someone who's is maybe in the office, in a junior management position, or he's had a promotion, and so he's bought himself something a little bit fancy to distinguish himself from the hoi polloi. As Britain back then, it was so rigidly class orientated, not just basic classes as in working class and middle class. It was every social strata according to which job that you did. And everything in your life really was dictated by that social strata. And if you're that kind of person, the desire to elevate to the next social strata was always present. And so as soon as you got a promotion off the shop floor, for instance, it could be someone who's been a foreman, and then he would probably have got himself a rally or something like that. Or, you know, his first new bike, maybe. He's now maybe being elevated into the office. The first thing he would change would be his hat. Hats were a peculiarly obsessive denoter of status in Britain back in those days. This bike would not be ridden by someone in a cloth Peaky Blinders style cap. That was for the shop floor workers, the miners and people like that. This would be ridden by someone in a trilby. I don't think he would be up to the bowler hat class yet. I don't think the bowler hatted brigade would have ridden to work on a bicycle. They would have got the training to work. Maybe a bicycle for weekends, quite possibly. This may be someone who's got, 1933, I mean, you know, he might have got an early Austin 7 or something like that. But really not many people would have had a car. He might have a motorcycle sidecar combination for weekends and use this for work. But that really, most of that came later. We're still in the in the era of people walking to work, getting the bus, maybe the train. Yeah, so this chap would have been a trilby chap, I think. And whenever I ride a bike like this, or I'm close to a bike like this, I do start maybe romanticising, I don't know, but I start looking at it and thinking, who are you? Who are you? Who's the person who bought this bike? I'm riding their bike. I'm holding their handlebars. And they're obviously not going to be around anymore. But here I am riding their bike. Whose bike am I riding? I want to know about the person. It's just part of the fascination with old things. I think it comes naturally to anyone who's into old stuff. You want to know the history. You want to know something about the person who originally bought it. Where did he buy it from? What did he buy it for? What job was he cycling to? Where did he live originally? Because, yeah, this was bought from Blackpool, but seaside resorts, you see. A bike bought in the 30s could have got to the 1950s and the person has retired to the seaside. And then it's sat in a shed after they've died in maybe the 60s or 70s. That would fit the narrative. Things end up in seaside resorts. They don't necessarily start out here. And that includes people. And so, in true tradition, put some air in the tyres and have a go. We have that one rear brake, which I'm pulling now. And it's just holding us back nicely on the rusty rims. I think it's the friction of the rust is holding us back there. So I'm not legal to ride on the road, certainly not. Nor would I want to, until I've sorted it out. Another feature, of course, of bikes of that era, very high gearing. I'm going along at a decent clip now, and my legs are hardly turning the pedals, because of course, having no cable, it's jammed into top gear. It will be getting new tyres, something smoother. I have something in mind. Having looked at the catalogue pictures, I have something in mind that'll be more like factory spec. Not just in mind, but in stock. So that was a pleasant little ride, and the handlebars are a bit loose, so I'm being very circumspect. And I happened to ride past the Wild Coast Memorial Arboretum with all the various war memorials. And that kind of brings it home, a bike this age, 90 years old. None of that has happened. Things that we see as the dim and distant past had not yet happened when this bike was made. It really was born into a different world. So, thanks for coming along with me. I hope you like the bike. It's going to be the subject of forthcoming videos. Not immediately, and because I have to get this maroon superb done, ready to go down to Essex, to Chris. And then I have to decide whether to do the Boulevard Tourist, the Curry's Elizabethan, or this. I know what you're all saying, it's going to be this, isn't it? I don't know, I mean, this is so nearly there, but so is the Boulevard. I'll see, I might do them alongside each other. But anyway, thanks very much, and we'll see you very shortly with the next video, which will probably be a tinkering video, I should think, since I've got so much tinkering to do. Unless I can sneak a ride in. So don't forget to give a thumbs up, make sure you're subscribed, share it on your social media. It all helps the videos get seen and helps me stay on air, really. And as usual, I will ask if you're able to contribute anything by PayPal or Patreon. Please consider doing that. Anything that the channel makes is what keeps the channel going. It's not my bread and butter money, and I don't tend to use my bread and butter money to buy bikes with either. That tends to be, I try and keep the hobby within itself and self-circulating. So thanks very much for watching. See you soon. Bye bye now.